Welcome to today's program. The second generation of a successful diesel engine, the 3.0-liter V6 TDI, is on everyone's lips. The high-volume engine is installed in the Audi A4, Q5, Q7 and A8. It features the latest diesel technology with the piezo common rail system, a low-emission engine with low fuel consumption. This is achieved by using up to 2,000 bar of rail pressure and consistent thermal management, as well as by optimizing friction and employing the start-stop system and recuperation. I'd like to welcome Wolfgang Mattes from Audi Service Training.
Wolfgang. Hallo Petra.
What will we be talking about today?
We'll be talking about differences between the first and second generation. We'll take a look at what these developments mean for mechanics and customers alike. And we'll take a look at AdBlue or clean diesel for the 3.0-liter V6 TDI engine.
Let's start with today's first topic.
Second generation Audi 3.0-liter V6 TDI. Intake manifold and cylinder head.
How do the first and second generation intake manifolds differ?
I have here a new intake manifold. This one is plastic, not cast aluminium. And there are no swirl flaps in the intake section. This means there are two less motors and six flaps, plus connecting rod, etc. These have been replaced by this center-mounted swirl flap.
We have a graphic to illustrate this.
Here we can take a look inside the intake manifold. We can see by way of the parting line that the intake manifold is split horizontally, into an upper part and a lower part. The upper part extends above this swirl flap. The flap replaces the six flaps that were previously here. The swirl flap closes the charging ducts. Only then can the three yellow swirl ducts become active. Closing the ducts creates the swirl in the cylinder. The benefit is that the same airflow is sent to all six cylinders, and the swirl flap is closed uniformly. Making it simpler and more reliable. A little further down the intake manifold, we can see the throttle valve. Here is the inlet for the exhaust gas recirculation. The exhaust gas recirculation is controlled centrally for six cylinders in the intake stream. Therefore, all six cylinders receive the same amount of recirculated exhaust gas.
How does this cylinder head differ from the first generation?
The cylinder head no longer has a ladder frame. Bearing brackets are used instead. The cylinder head is simpler in design, and the drive chain sprockets are larger because they're not as complex.
Do we require a special tool to remove the cylinder head?
Yes, we need this special tool. We use it to secure the chain tensioner when removing the cylinder head. This is done when the engine is fitted.
We'll now watch a film to see how this tool is used.
The new second-generation 3.0-liter V6 TDI engine from Audi. This film will show you how to remove the cylinder head. This is a summary of the most important work steps. Each specific work step is contained in the workshop manual. First, we remove the turbocharger as per the workshop manual. That's what the new flange looks like. These are the intake bores. And here is the oil supply and return. This is the coolant supply. Now let's remove the intake manifold. Unlike the first generation, there are no swell flaps in this intake manifold. The cylinder head cover can now be removed. Don't forget to remove the injectors. Incidentally, these are bolted onto the cylinder head from the outside. This is what the new cylinder head looks like. It's easy to see that the ladder frame is missing. There are now four bearing brackets on each that support the camshafts. Now let's remove the cover for the chain guard on cylinder bank 1. Use adjusting pin T40060 to specify the basic camshaft setting. TDC was found earlier using locating screw 3242. The new locking device for chain tensioner T40246 is now fitted. The short screws fix the chain guard housing, while the long ones fix the chain tensioner. Cover the opening with a clean cloth. This prevents any small parts falling through the time chain box opening into the engine. Remove the adjusting pin and undo the screws on the chain sprocket. Then remove the screws from the chain tensioner and the guide rail. Remove the chain sprocket by pulling it forwards and place it to one side. To continue the removal process, now secure the bearing brackets. These consist of two parts. Use the appropriate cable ties to secure each bearing bracket. Now you can continue removing the cylinder head as per the workshop manual. Second generation Audi 3.0 litre V6 TDI. High pressure pump and chain drive.
The high-pressure pump is now driven by the chain drive, not the toothed belt. What else has changed?
The high-pressure pump is now installed behind on the chain drive. It used to be fitted at the front on the toothed belt. This eliminates the need for the toothed belt and the drive parts from the camshaft to the high-pressure pump. The high-pressure pump is installed using this special tool in the form of a rig pin. It intercepts the chain sprocket from the high-pressure pump and prevents the chain and chain sprocket from falling into the chain box.
We've prepared a film to explain this.
Now we'll look at how to remove and install the high-pressure pump. It's been moved from the front of the engine to behind the chain drive. This means the toothed belt drive from the first generation is no longer needed. Remove the fixture for the turbocharger. Here we can clearly see the high-pressure pump chain drive. To continue removing the high-pressure pump, we need to dismantle the exhaust gas recirculation system. We also need to remove the engine oil cooler and the coolant shut-off valve as per the workshop manual. Insert rig pin T40245 into the oblong hole to prevent the high-pressure pump chain sprocket dropping down. The engine block has a borehole for this purpose. You can now remove the three fastening bolts for the high-pressure pump. Remove the high-pressure pump from its mounting. Before fitting the new pump, you need to convert the old pusher for the new pump. The fastening nut can be opened using the counterhole tool T40248. Now remove the pusher as per the workshop manual. Note: the pusher's installation position is specified by a tongue and groove system. Please note the following as you continue to install the high-pressure pump. This recess in the pusher must match the dual toothing in the chain sprocket. The remaining installation steps are carried out in reverse sequence as per the workshop manual.
What's new on the chain drive?
It's a completely new design. In comparison with the first generation, it has one chain less in the camshaft area and one less chain here too. And there aren't any deflecting chain sprockets. Instead of four chains, there are two. A long chain runs from the crank drive over the camshaft drive and from there over the balancer shaft to the next camshaft. It has 206 links. Thus begs the question of the chain elongating over its lifespan. The chain sleeves and sprockets have a special material coating to prevent this. The chain sleeves don't wear, and elongation is negligible. The second chain runs over the auxiliary drive, down over the high-pressure pump, and then over the auxiliary drive with the oil and vacuum pump. The vacuum pump is now located inside the engine, not on the cylinder head.
What's the benefit of the new chain drive?
There are far fewer rotating parts. These do create a resistance, which in turn increases fuel consumption. So having just two chain drives means less friction in the engine. There are fewer components overall, such as two chain tensioners instead of four, two chains instead of four, and also fewer guide rails used to route the chain. All these changes make for a lighter engine.
What is the weight reduction?
We've reduced the weight by 25 kilograms. That's a big saving for an engine from one generation to the next.
That brings us on to our next topic.
Second generation Audi 3.0 liter V6 TDI thermal management.
What do we mean by thermal management?
Thermal management is becoming increasingly important in engine technology. We want to utilize temperatures where they're most needed. Vehicle heating takes top priority, for instance. All of the heat is fed to the heat exchanger inside the vehicle. The exchanger is then heated up very quickly. Maintaining the engine at a high temperature is also important, which is why we have a two-part cooling system. The light blue areas are for cooling the cylinder head. The dark blue areas are for cooling the engine block. It's split in two because there are two separate areas. The first via the characteristics thermostat. This can now be opened even wider by being energized from the engine control unit. This enlarges the cross-section and controls the coolant supply from the cooler into the cylinder head area. The second area of the block cooling works via this ball valve. This ball valve sits on the supply line in the engine block. Water does not run into the cylinder head when the ball valve closes. That's how we control engine block cooling. Each area also has a temperature sensor. One for the block cooling. This is located in the warmest place on the engine near the combustion chamber. The second temperature sensor for the cylinder head circulation is positioned here, close to the exhaust gas recirculation cooling. That's how the engine control unit always knows which temperature prevails where. Below the block, we want to run a very high temperature of up to 105 degrees Celsius. The temperature varies in the cylinder head area. The cooler supply can be controlled via the characteristics thermostat in line with the ambient temperature. In ideal conditions, we have head temperatures from 65 to 90 degrees Celsius. Being able to produce these temperatures is important. Here we can see the exhaust gas recirculation cooler. It's integrated in the cylinder head area. Let's assume the exhaust gas recirculation cooler is cooled by coolant at a temperature of approximately 65 degrees Celsius. The exhaust gas temperature will drop and the temperature in the combustion chamber will fall, and fewer emissions are produced. Volumetric efficiency, torque and output are all optimized.
How are the two cooling circuits controlled?
They're controlled by the engine control unit via this ball valve, which can be continuously opened and closed. When the valve is open, the coolant flows up here to the cylinder head area. It mixes here with the cooler coolant and controls the block temperature. The valve opens at an engine block temperature of approximately 105 degrees Celsius. If the cylinder block falls below 105 degrees Celsius, as read by the temperature sensor, the valve will close again. This process allows the temperature to remain constant. Here the valve is closed and no coolant flows into the cylinder head. So we have static coolant in the block and flowing coolant in the cylinder head. The thermal management system keeps the engine block, that is, the engine gearbox unit, warm.
We now turn to the oil cooler bypass thermostat. What does that have to do with the thermal management system, and where is it located on the engine?
The temperature in the engine block needs to be high, but not too high. The oil should have low viscosity. Engine gearbox unit, crankshaft, piston rod, etc. rotate more easily than when the engine is cold. A warm free-moving engine has less internal friction. Therefore, this component optimizes friction.
And how high do we keep the temperature?
Up to 103 degrees Celsius in the oil area. Anything above this and the thermostat will open. The oil cooler is integrated in the circuit, keeping oil at this temperature.
That's the benefit of having 103 centigrade?
Friction is at its best in this temperature range. Previously, we didn't need the oil cooler. If we drive the car under load, the oil temperature rises to above 120 degrees Celsius. The oil cooler is then fully integrated in the circuit and the oil is cooled down. By doing this, the engine isn't damaged.
The second generation 3.0-liter V6 TDI engine is also available as clean diesel. So let's take another look at how to refuel the AdBlue tank.
Second generation Audi 3.0-liter V6 TDI, clean diesel and AdBlue.
We've already discussed clean diesel in a previous program. Why are we coming back to it now?
The clean diesel concept is available in several vehicles, such as in the Q7, as well as in the Q5 with the 2.0-liter TDI engine, and in the A4 and the new A8.
Und natürlich ist auch dann im neuen A8 als clean diesel.
What should we look out for when refueling with AdBlue?
We must ensure that we use the correct tools. This key opens the lock on the AdBlue tank. This means there's no risk of confusion with the lock on the fuel tank. Let me just open the cap on the fuel tank.
Und setze dann, jetzt tauschen wir uns die Werkzeuge, füllen dann diese...
Then we add this bottle of AdBlue to the tank.
Halbe Gallone.
It's half a gallon, about 2 liters.
AdBlue, dieses setzen wir...
The bottle has a valve which seals it.
Man sieht hier oben schon...
This is the way that customers refuel AdBlue.
Dass hier nichts rauslaufen kann.
Screw the bottle onto the lock and push it down.
Nachfüllmöglichkeit für den Kunden, was ich hier zeige, schraubt es auf den Verschluss drauf. Und wenn das festgeschraubt hat, nimmt er nichts, macht er nichts anderes als mit der flachen Hand hier nach unten drücken und öffnet jetzt den
All the AdBlue runs into the tank.
Und es läuft das ganze AdBlue in
the tank vents into the bottle to prevent vapors from escaping.
In die Flasche hinein, sodass keine Gase nach außen treten können oder sonstige Sachen nach außen treten können. Es ist Harnstoff.
Urea can indeed be odorous.
Is one bottle enough?
Nein, grundsätzlich, wenn die Kontrollanzeige kommt...
If the warning message in the instrument cluster comes on, you should add 2 bottles, which is about 4 liters.
Und dann haben wir so viel reingefüllt...
The warning will then disappear and the customer can continue to the workshop, where the system will be topped up.
...machen muss, fahren kann und dann in die Werkstatt geht zum Vollmachen wieder das ganze System.
Should you always carry 2 bottles with you?
No, maybe at home in the garage. However, you shouldn't store AdBlue for longer than a year in cruise bottles. It can be kept for up to 4 years in the tank.
What's the procedure for refueling in the workshop?
Mechanics
can fill the system right to the top.
dieses System komplett zu befüllen. Dazu kennt er dieses.
They need to use the engine jack and the special tool.
Hier dazu gibt's dieses Spezialwerkzeug dazu mit 6542.
They need to use the engine jack and the special tool VAS6542.
Und auch die Aufnahmeplatte für den,
which comprises the canister, support plate and filling device. The canister has a scale, so we know how much AdBlue has been added. To start the filling process, this hose must be attached to the canister.
Und hier drüber, über diesen Stutzen, sieht man, der schaut auf länger in den Tank hinein als der Verschluss.
This nozzle goes into the tank. AdBlue comes out at the front and the tank vent is located here on the side.
In den Behälter entlüften.
The canister is vented, preventing vapors from escaping. We screw the nozzle to the bottle as before.
Schrauben wie vor die große Flasche hier auch drauf. Schraubt das Teil richtig schön fest.
As soon as everything is connected, we open the airline here at the top.
Die Luftleitung. Und hier unten
the fluid line is opened at the bottom.
Und so wird es hier ausgetauscht.
Fluid flows into the tank and the air is removed from the canister. This ensures that it's a clean process.
Does everything need to be shut off again? How long does refueling take?
When the tank is full, you will be able to see AdBlue in the tank nozzle. And if no air can escape, no more fluid can enter the tank. Once the fluid stops flowing, it will be clear that the tank is full. We shut off the lines and dismantle everything.
Und dann kann ich das wieder abbauen. Und ist eine saubere
Sache. Thanks to the longer nozzle, the fluid level lies below the opening, which means that nothing can escape.
So läuft auch nichts mehr raus und gibt keine Versauerei oder sonstige Sachen im Bereich des.
How long does the entire process take?
As it's not a pressurized fueling process, it can take several minutes. You need to ensure that the container is higher than the filling neck. The tank takes 23 liters. The tank at the top is active and the one at the bottom is passive.
Der Passivtank, wo nur die Flüssigkeit praktisch mitgeführt wird, sitzt unten.
The long line means it takes some time for the fluid to actually get to the passive tank.
Aktivtank runterläuft in den Passivtank. Es kann schon einige Minuten dauern.
Ja, jetzt habe ich noch eine abschließende Frage an dich, Wolfgang, und zwar:
Is there any supplementary literature on this subject?
Ja.
There's a self-study program 479, which is about the second generation 3.0-liter V6 TDI engine. The program includes information regarding all parts, product innovations, designs and functions, and consolidates knowledge.
Wolfgang Mattes from Audi Service Training, thank you for all this information. You can also find a theory test on today's program on the ATO platform. Goodbye, until next time.
Zur heutigen Sendung zu machen. Wir wünschen viel Spaß dabei, sagen danke für Ihr Interesse. Bis zum nächsten Mal. Tschüss und auf Wiedersehen.
Tschüss.